Unlike heart rate, which measures the number of times your heart beats per minute, heart rate variability, or HRV, focuses on the variation in time intervals between consecutive heartbeats, which are known as interbeat intervals, or IBIs. HRV is a practical, non-invasive, and cost-effective way to measure the activity of the autonomic nervous system.
Our bodies are continuously readjusting to maintain a state of balance called homeostasis. Our heart rate, blood pressure, glucose level, hormones, and more react to the stressors we face, and the autonomic nervous system works to keep everything in balance so that we can function optimally. Heart rhythm, and therefore HRV, at rest is regulated by the parasympathetic nervous system. The upshot is that measuring your HRV is an effective way to capture your body's response to stress. The concept of HRV dates back to the 18th century, but key to its accurate implementation was the invention of the ECG in the 19th century. By the 1960s, HRV emerged as a useful indicator of autonomic function. This period saw the emergence of lots of different methods to quantify HRV, including time domain, frequency domain, and nonlinear analyses. We'll talk about these later.
Early clinical research focused on the relationship between HRV and cardiovascular health. Studies demonstrated that reduced HRV was associated with a higher risk of adverse cardiovascular events and mortality in populations with heart disease. This backed up the idea that HRV provided a simple, non-invasive method to assess cardiovascular disease risk. HRV then began to be explored in other clinical settings.
Today, the application of HRV has expanded beyond clinical research into sports science and general wellness, particularly with the widespread adoption of wearable devices like the Apple Watch, Fitbit, and several Garmin devices, which all provide a measure of HRV. Athletes and coaches started to use HRV as a measure of training adaptation and recovery. The idea being that, by monitoring HRV, athletes can gauge their body's response to training loads and assess their recovery and prevent overtraining.
The sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems work in tandem to maintain cardiac homeostasis. In simple terms, the sympathetic nervous system typically responds to stress by accelerating heart rate, while the parasympathetic nervous system promotes relaxation and recovery, decelerating heart rate. HRV reflects this balance. Higher variability generally indicates a healthy, responsive heart capable of efficiently adapting to changing environmental demands, whereas a lower HRV generally means that the heart is less adaptable.
Broadly speaking, HRV can be calculated in three ways: in the time domain, the frequency domain, or using nonlinear analyses. Each method offers a different perspective on the underlying dynamics of heart rate.
Time domain analysis involves using statistical measures of the time intervals between consecutive heartbeats, which are defined by the heart's electrical signal. The part of the signal used to delineate one heartbeat from another can vary, but or intervals are commonly used. Or here refers to the peak of the QRS complex of the heart's electrical signal, and the interval between these peaks. Normal to normal, or NN intervals, are also used. NN intervals refer to the intervals between normal or peaks. You see, sometimes during measurement, artifacts can happen due to arrhythmic events or faulty sensors, and this can lead to abnormal or peaks, which may in turn distort the statistics of HRV measurement. In any case, common time domain metrics include the standard deviation of NN intervals, or SDNN, which is one of the simplest and most widely used HRV parameters. SDNN has a long history in research and clinical settings, having been mostly used for 24-hour measurements in patient populations. It's also the default HRV measure that the Apple Watch records. The idea is that by looking at SDNN, you can get an understanding of HRV changes throughout the day in response to, say, circadian rhythm or acute stressors. It has mainly been used to distinguish between having no variability at all versus a healthy, adaptable cardiovascular system. We'll talk about the challenges of taking 24-hour measurements of HRV later, but the main shortcoming of SDNN over the other time domain measures like RMSSD, which I'll talk about in a second, comes down to its mathematics. While most metrics tend to capture variability, SDNN only captures deviations from the mean, not high-frequency beat-to-beat changes due to vagal activity. The root mean square of the successive differences, or RMSSD, is another time domain measure. Unlike SDNN, it represents the root mean square of differences between successive normal to normal intervals. This means that RMSSD is better able to capture short-term changes in heart rhythm. There are several other advantages of RMSSD over SDNN as a measure of HRV. It's easy to calculate, values can be compared across studies, and it is time invariant, so using a shorter or longer time window still provides relatively comparable results. When it comes to frequency domain analysis, the term frequency doesn't refer to the heart rate itself. It's actually a reference to the rate at which oscillations in heart rate variability occur. Essentially, we're interested in how the intervals between consecutive heartbeats, those interbeat intervals, change. These changes can be slow, fast, or somewhere in between. The frequency domain analysis of HRV is about understanding the rate at which these interbeat intervals change and the balance of the autonomic nervous system control exerted at these rates.
So there are the two kinds of linear measures of HRV. They rely on the assumption that heart rate dynamics follow a predictable linear pattern and are based on statistical and mathematical techniques that assume a regular proportional relationship between various elements of the heart rate signal. Linear methods are widely used because they are relatively straightforward to calculate and interpret, and they do provide valuable information about the overall level of HRV and the balance between the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems. Nonlinear methods, on the other hand, recognize that heart rate dynamics are not always linear or predictable. Your heart's signal can exhibit complex patterns that are not captured by traditional linear methods, which average out certain complexities. Nonlinear measures like Poincaré plot analysis, entropy measures, and detrended fluctuation analysis can reveal aspects of heart rate variability that linear methods miss. So we've talked about the methods of analysis, but not how to take a measurement of HRV. This is vital because HRV is really sensitive to different environmental or contextual factors. This means that if you don't follow a consistent protocol and measure your HRV at the right times, the measurement isn't going to mean much, regardless of whether you use the time domain, frequency domain, or nonlinear methods of analysis.
Essentially, there are three approaches to taking a HRV measurement. You can monitor your HRV over a full 24-hour period, over a short-term period, typically around 5 minutes, or over what's known as an ultra-short-term period, which is less than 5 minutes. Regardless of whether you're taking a 24-hour, a short-term, or an ultra-short-term period, though, there are a few general principles that need to be followed when measuring HRV. First, it's important to ensure consistency in the measurement conditions. For HRV to be a reliable indicator, it should be measured under a similar physiological and environmental conditions each time. This means taking measurements at the same time of day, ideally in a rested state, like immediately after waking up or after sitting quietly for a few minutes. This helps to minimize the influence of external factors like physical activity, mental stress, caffeine, or meal timing, which can all significantly impact HRV readings. Second, your posture during measurement plays a significant role. Generally speaking, it's recommended to maintain a consistent posture, usually lying down or sitting, during each measurement session, and this shouldn't be changed during serial measures that you plan to compare HRV values over. Third, because breathing patterns are known to have a big influence on HRV, your breathing should either be controlled during serial measures or you should just breathe naturally without any consideration of your respiratory rate. Which approach to take here is the subject of ongoing debate. The main thing is that you should consider which is the most appropriate and stick with it. Don't mingle HRV measures where the breathing is controlled with those where it's not. Fourth, the duration of the measurement needs to be consistent. While 24-hour monitoring provides a comprehensive overview of HRV across different states, it requires sophisticated equipment and is mostly used in clinical research settings. It's also prone to contextual factors that might make the readings meaningless. Short-term and ultra-short-term measurements, in contrast, are more practical for daily monitoring and are commonly used in both clinical settings and for personal health tracking. Lastly, your choice of which HRV metrics and the analysis methods you use should align with the measurement duration and the specific goals of monitoring.